This is Turkish television in eastern Turkey, in the area of the Kurds. Well, here we are at Diyarbakir in eastern Turkey, in the Hotel Güler, which we're staying overnight. We're waiting for a bus to turn up. It's an hour and a half late, so this is fairly typical of life in eastern Turkey, as is what you can see on the left-hand side.
We're standing in front of the Tigris River. Tigris River is first mentioned in the Bible in Genesis chapter 2, where there was four rivers that went out of the Garden of Eden. There was the Euphrates River, the Hiddekel. Hiddekel is the other name for the river Tigris. The other place that we find the Tigris River was Daniel, in Daniel chapter 10, was standing on the side of the river, wasn't he? When a certain man, that was the man of the one, came and spoke to him and gave him that marvellous vision of the multitudinous Christ being revealed. So this is the river that also marks the edge of Mesopotamia, the space between the river, or the land between the river. And Mesopotamia runs between this river here, the Tigris River, and the Euphrates River, which we're going to see later in our travels. And when Stephen spoke made his speech in Acts chapter 7, he said that the God of glory appeared to our fathers in the Ur of the Chaldees when he was in Mesopotamia. So Mesopotamia moved all the way from Ur, which was on the banks of the Euphrates and the Tigris, all the way up to Haran and right over to here. So we're standing in Mesopotamia. In the Old Testament terms, Mesopotamia was known as Aram Naharaim. That is, Naharaim is rivers of Syria, the land of Syria between the rivers. So Naharaim, Aram, which is found in the title of Psalm 60, when David came in his conquests and he took Aram Naharaim. And so this land of Mesopotamia was where David had one of his conquests.
Diyarbakir, Mosul, and Baghdad.
Right.
Thank you.
We've come to a very significant part of our journey. We're sitting on ancient stones that form part of a gate into the city of Haran. And of course it was to Haran that Terah brought his family according to the record of Genesis chapter 11. When God had appeared to Abram, his son, in Ur of the Chaldees, and given him the promise that he would show him a land. However, that land had not been described to Abram in that promise. And so the Apostle Paul records in Hebrews chapter 11 at verse 8, by faith, Abraham,
when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. The call for him to leave Ur of the Chaldees came in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. The city of Ur was very significant in ancient times. It signifies the light of the conquerors, according to Davis. It was the largest city of Shinar, and Shinar in its Hebrew form is the name of Semiramis in its Akkadian form. So when we read Shinar in the scriptures, we immediately think of the wife of Nimrod, Semiramis. So here was Abram in the very heart of the apostasy of that time, an apostasy formed by the association of Cush and Nimrod. Cush, the father of Nimrod, was the great original prophet of the Babylonian mysteries, and he was the one who developed the doctrines and the practices that were picked up by his son Nimrod. And of course Nimrod's wife was Semiramis. And so God plucks Abram from the very heart of Nimrodian apostasy of ancient Babylon and calls upon him to depart and to leave for a land that he doesn't know where it is yet, but a land that God would give him, providing he met the three conditions that were laid down in Genesis chapter 12. They departed from Ur of the Chaldees, this ancient centre of astrology. Ur of the Chaldees was the home of the moon god Nanna, otherwise known as Sin, S-I-N. The other most important centre of the worship of the moon god was the city of Haran. And it's a remarkable fact that when Terah left Ur of the Chaldees, not knowing whither they were to go, that he made his way, he led his family along the Euphrates, and they came to this place, to Haran. I wonder why Terah chose to come here. Well, I think perhaps the suggestion could be that he came here because this was the second most important place of the worship of the gods that he and his family had served up to that time. And Terah, of course, did not leave Haran. He died here, which would suggest that he never really left behind the worship of the gods of Ur of the Chaldees. And we know, of course, in Joshua chapter 24, that Joshua reminded Israel that God had called their fathers from the other side of the flood, where they had worshipped other gods. And so when Abram came to Haran, he had some choices to make, because it was here that God repeated the promise of Genesis 12 verses 1 to 3 and called upon him to go to the land that he would show him. And so Abram became Abram the Hebrew. He crossed over the Euphrates and made his way south to Damascus and then into the land, coming initially in Genesis chapter 12 to Shechem. So here we are in this place, Haran, that was to be so crucial not only in the life of Abram, when at 75 years of age, he made his way across the Euphrates to the land of promise. It was also to play a very important part in the life of Jacob. For here he came, fleeing from the face of his brother Esau, who sought to kill him after Jacob had stolen his blessing. And his father Isaac sent him here to find a wife from the family of Terah that remained in this place, who had, of course, some semblance of understanding and appreciation of the promises made to Abraham. And so he came and found not only one wife, but he actually ended up with four in due time, and spent 40 years here in the company of Laban, the brother of his mother Rebecca, because he had obeyed the voice of his mother and had set out in Genesis 27 to deceive his father Isaac to steal the blessing that he didn't really want because it was not the blessing that Jacob really sought. It was a blessing that pertained to the things of the earth, to the things of the present. The only element of the blessing that was stolen by Jacob was that aspect of blessing and cursing. All the rest was given away by him later on when he returned to the land after 40 years in the company of the inveterate deceiver Laban, that he might learn not to deceive. So this place is very, very important in the history of the patriarchs, and we begin our journey as we follow their path into the land from this place.
Just come to get fuel so we can let our driver go home.
Yeah.